Jeremiah spoke of false teachers who cry peace when God has not spoken peace. God never sends a message of peace to the unsanctified to lull them to sleep in the cradle of worldly security. God rather sends a message of rebuke. He lays heavy burdens on the conscience of the wrongdoer, showing him the fearful judgments coming upon sinners so that the person will have a sense of his dire need. That is why that before the Messiah could come, a message had to be sent to the world in advance of his arrival. That's also the reason that before Jesus comes back to this world again, a message has to be sent to the world to prepare it for his coming. Are you ready for Jesus to come? We'll look at the message of preparation in just a moment.
Welcome to Steps to Life with Dr. John Grossbaugh.
Sabbath rest is a promise between God and his children.
Bible prophecy tells us that we are living in the last days of this earth's history before Jesus' second coming. Today's program will help you prepare for these coming events. Stay tuned.
Thanks for joining us. Isaiah the prophet predicted 700 years before Christ came that before the Messiah would come, there would be a special messenger that would be sent to prepare the way for the Messiah. He said it would be a voice crying in the wilderness and saying, prepare the way. You can read that in Isaiah the 40th chapter. Why was it necessary to send a special messenger before the coming of Christ the first time? The next question is it necessary to send a special messenger before the coming of Christ the second time? We'll look at both of those questions, but first, let's pray and ask the Lord to help us understand what we'll read from His holy book. Father in heaven, we thank you for Bible prophecy that explains what is going to happen in the future and how to get ready for it. And we know from Bible prophecy you have told us that this world is headed for an overwhelming surprise. And we pray that you will help us by studying Bible prophecy to know what to do to be ready. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's free book is entitled, Once Saved, Always Saved. To receive your free book, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer IM9. Many Christians can tell you the exact day that they became saved, but is it possible to be saved at one point and lose it? What does the Bible teach about this important subject? To receive your free gift, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer IM9.
In the Gospel of Luke, Luke the physician gives the following account of what occurred approximately a year and a half before Jesus was born in Bethlehem. It says, there was in the days of Herod the king of Judea a certain priest named Zacharias of the division of Abijah. His wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blameless. But they had no child, because Elizabeth was barren, and they were both well advanced in years. So it was that while he was serving as priest before God in the order of his division, according to the custom of the priesthood, his lot fell to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people was praying outside at the hour of incense. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing on the right side of the altar of incense, and when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John, and you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will also be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will also go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Well, that was a wonderful message. Zechariah had prayed for many years that he could have a child, and it appeared that his prayers would never be answered. But now, when he was an old man, The angel appears to him in the temple and says to him, you are going to have a child. You and your wife are going to have a child. And Zechariah then got to thinking and he said, how is this going to be? The angel promised that this child would be a prophet who would prepare the way for the Messiah, to prepare a people for the coming of the Lord. But Zechariah got to thinking, he thought, well, I'm an old man. My wife is old. How will that ever happen? Now, he knew the story of Abraham and Sarah. They thought that it couldn't happen either. That's the time in Genesis 18 when God told Abraham and Sarah, he said, is anything too hard for the Lord? And so we see Zechariah thinking about the same thing. And so it says here in verse 18, Zechariah said to the angel, how shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is well advanced in years. And the angel answered and said to him, I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God and was sent to speak to you and bring you these glad tidings. But behold, you will be mute and not able to speak until the day these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their own time. And the people waited for Zacharias and marveled that he lingered so long in the temple. But when he came out, he could not speak to them. And they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he beckoned to them and remained speechless. And so it then says that he went to his house after those days, and his wife Elizabeth conceived, and she hid herself 5 months, saying, thus the Lord has dealt with me in the days when he looked on me to take away my reproach. Why was this? Why does this happen over and over again in the Bible? It happened to Abraham and Sarah. God promised Abraham a son, but their promise was delayed for about 25 years until Abraham was impotent, Sarah had passed menopause, and it was apparently impossible. And then the Lord said, no, you're still going to have a son. The Lord said the same thing here to Gabriel, to Zechariah, when he was an old man and his wife was old. Why did God do this? Oh, friend, the reason for these stories in the Bible is to teach us a spiritual truth that is hard for us to learn and easy for us to forget. And that is simply this. You and I are incapable of ourselves of doing any good thing. The Bible is very clear about this. But that which we cannot do will be worked out for us by the power of God if we submit to Him and believe in Him. So it was through faith that Isaac was born. It is through faith that spiritual life is begotten, and we are enabled to do the works of righteousness. Well, the time came. John the Baptist was born. It says in Luke 1:57, now Elizabeth's full time came for her to be delivered, and she brought forth a son. When her neighbors and relatives heard how the Lord had shown great mercy to her, they rejoiced with her. And on the eighth day, then it records that on the eighth day when he was circumcised, and when his father said his name was John, wrote it on a tablet, that then his mouth was opened and his tongue loosed. And then it says, fear came on all who dwelt around them, and all these sayings were discussed throughout all the hill country of Judea. And all those who heard them kept them in their hearts, saying, what kind of child will this be? And the hand of the Lord was with him. Zechariah rehearsed the prophecy of Isaiah. He said concerning this child, you can read it in Luke 1, he said, this one is going to go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give salvation to his people, to teach them how they can have forgiveness of their sins, to give light to those that sit in darkness, and to guide our ways, our paths, into the way of peace. Well, John the Baptist grew up and studied what was going on around him. He dwelt in the desert, as it says in Luke, and it is predicted that he would dwell in the book of Isaiah. And he realized that he was going to have to give a new direction to people's thoughts. He was going to have to impress men with the holiness of God's requirements and their need of perfect righteousness. And he could not do this unless he himself was living a holy life and practicing self-control. That's why you read the words of Gabriel. He said to his to Zechariah before the child was ever conceived, this child is not to drink strong drink, not to drink alcoholic beverages, because that will prevent him from accomplishing his mission. The Apostle Paul is talking about this same concept in 1 Corinthians, the 9th chapter. He talks about the need for the Christian having self-control. And he says in conclusion in 1 Corinthians 9:24 to 27, "Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may obtain it. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable. Therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty. Thus I fight, not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should be disqualified." John the Baptist began to preach. When he was about 30 years of age, he began to preach from the wilderness in Judea. And it records what he began to preach to the people here in Luke, the 3rd chapter. It says, "He said to the multitudes that came out to be baptized by him, 'Brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore bring fruits worthy of repentance, and do not begin to say to yourselves, We have Abraham as our father, for I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. And even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Therefore every tree which does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire.' So the people asked him, saying, 'What shall we do then?' He answered and said to them, 'He who has two tunics, let him give to him who has none. And he who has food, let him do likewise.' Then tax collectors also came to be baptized and said to him, 'Teacher, what shall we do?' And he said to them, 'Collect no more than what is appointed for you.' Likewise, the soldiers asked him, saying, 'What shall we do?' So he said to them, 'Do not intimidate anyone,'" in other words, treat anyone with violence, "'or accuse falsely, and be content with your wages.'" So John began to preach a message not just of revival, but a message of reformation of life. He showed the people there has to be a change in the way you live. Your heart has to be changed, and there has to be a change in the way you live. He said to them, "Repent, because the kingdom of heaven is at hand." The word repent means to change your mind. Change your mind about sin. Matthew records the very same message like this in Matthew, the 7th chapter, and verses 3 to 12, it says, or 7 to 12, "When he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to his baptism, he said to them, 'Brood of vipers, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore bear fruits worthy of repentance. And do not think to say to yourselves, We have Abraham to our father. For I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones.'" And then he says, "Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire." In other words, a tree that has the right name, a tree that's called Christian, for example, today, a tree that has the right name, in the day of judgment, your name won't save you. Your profession won't save you. It's only if you bear fruit that you will be saved in the day of judgment. That's what John the Baptist taught. And he said, concerning the coming of the Messiah, he said, "His winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." Now the Jews thought that they were God's people and that they would always be God's people and that they could not have their spiritual inheritance taken away from them. It could never happen. They interpreted Jeremiah 31, 35 to 37 that way, where the prophet said, well, if the sun and the moon, the stars, as long as they last, well, then the Jews will be my people. But they forgot to read the verses just before that where the Lord had said, "I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts and will be their God and they shall be my people. I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more." You see, that was the prerequisite to saying that they were going to be God's people forever. You see, if God's law is written in your heart, then to you the favor of God is assured, and you will be accounted as part of His people. But if you don't keep His law just because you have the right name, there is nothing that will keep you from getting destroyed in the day of judgment. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, that these things are written for those people upon whom the ends of the earth are come. Do we misinterpret God's blessings and flatter ourselves that we are the favored of God on account of His goodness to us when we are breaking His law and going directly contrary to His counsel? If the fruit is worthless, the name cannot save the tree. And so John told the Jewish people, he said, your standing before God is going to be determined by your character, by your life. It's not your profession. That's worthless. If your life, if your character are not in harmony with God's law, then you're not His people, no matter what your profession is. They didn't like that. People don't like that today. They want to be saved in their sins as long as they make a profession and go through religious ceremonies and systems. But to be saved, you must receive the Spirit of God into your heart that will consume sin and give you a new heart and a new life. If you cling to sin, then when Jesus comes and all sin is destroyed, you will be destroyed when all other sin is destroyed. That's why. Just before the second coming of Christ, just as God sent a special message so that men would be ready for the first coming of Christ, in the same way in the book of Revelation, just before the second coming of Christ, God sends a special message again so that men will be ready if they will listen. We'll look at that special message next.
Sometimes studying the Bible on your own without any help or guideline to follow can be a little difficult. And after confusion and frustration set in, we all too often turn to other things. If this sounds like you, you're not alone. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence School is just the answer. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for your free Bible Correspondence Starter Pack.
I really enjoy being able to study at home. I'm a new Christian, and I definitely knew I needed some guidance.
Simply review each lesson and answer the questions.
These studies were great. It just seemed like the Bible opened up for me.
Then send the completed lesson back to us in the envelope provided.
These studies were very professional. They didn't take a lot of time, and I really appreciated that.
A Bible teacher will then look over each lesson and send them back to you with the next set of studies. It's that simple and totally free. Call Steps to Life Television at 1-800-THE-TRUTH.
I'm so glad I called.
Welcome back. When Jesus came, the people of His time, the religious leaders and the organization of the Jewish church, did not receive Him. And they questioned His authority because Jesus did not have authorization from them to preach or teach. Of course, John the Baptist didn't have that authorization either. And neither of them could show you a card saying, I'm authorized by the leaders, by the rabbis, or by the Sanhedrin to teach. And so, according to Jewish thinking, neither one of them had any authority to teach, and they came in Matthew 21 and questioned Jesus' authority like this. It says, now when He came into the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people confronted Him as He was teaching and said, by what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority? But Jesus answered and said to them, I also will ask you one thing, which if you tell me, I likewise will tell you by what authority I do these things. The baptism of John, where was it from? From heaven or from men? And they reasoned among themselves, saying, if we say from heaven, He will say to us, why then did you not believe Him? But if we say from men, we fear the multitude, for all count John as a prophet. Neither Jesus nor John the Baptist had worldly or earthly authority to do what they were doing. But Jesus, when He was asked who gave Him this authority, He took them back in the providence of God to the ministry of John the Baptist, and He said, the baptism of John, whose authority was that from? Was it from the authority of heaven, or was it from the authority of the church organization? Now, if they should say it was on the authority of heaven, well, then John the Baptist had borne testimony and said, this is the Son of God. God has showed me this is the Son of God. You can read that in John, the first chapter. Of course, if they should say of men, they were afraid to say that. If they would say of men, if John the Baptist's ministry was not of heaven, well, then how could you know that Jesus was the Messiah? His coming would not be the fulfillment of prophecy if God had not sent a messenger beforehand. So they said, we couldn't tell. Jesus, on other occasions, made it very clear who John the Baptist was. In Matthew, the 11th chapter, this is what Jesus said about John the Baptist. He said, what did you go out to see? A man clothed in soft garments? Indeed, those who wear soft clothing are in king's houses. But what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I say to you, and more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you. Assuredly, I say to you, among those born of women, there has not risen one greater than John the Baptist. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he, that is, greater in privilege. In John the 17th chapter, the disciples had this very same question to Jesus. It says, as they came down from the mountain, that's the mountain of transfiguration, Jesus commanded them, saying, tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man is risen from the dead. And his disciples asked him, saying, why then do the scribes say that Elijah must come first? Then Jesus answered and said to them, Elijah truly is coming first and will restore all things. But I say to you that Elijah has come already, and they did not know him, but did to him whatever they wished. Likewise, the Son of Man is also about to suffer at their hands. Then the disciples understood that he spoke to them of John the Baptist. Notice what happened when Jesus came. The people were looking for certain things to happen. They were looking for certain prophecies to be fulfilled. The prophecies were fulfilled right in front of their eyes. But they didn't recognize it because they were looking for their prophecy to be fulfilled in a different way. Friend, the very same thing is happening today. As I visit with people, I find that people are trying to figure out the meaning of the prophecies in the book of Revelation. They're trying to figure out what is going to happen in the future. They're looking forward to some great event to happen in the future, and prophecy is being fulfilled right in front of their eyes. And they don't realize what is happening. It's just like it was in the days of John the Baptist. God has sent to this world a message that if anyone will listen to it, they will be prepared for the second coming of Christ. This message is found in Revelation, the 14th chapter, and verses 6 to 12. Immediately after this message is recorded, the next thing that is recorded in the book of Revelation is the coming of the Son of Man, the second coming of Christ. This message is written so that anybody in this world who wants to can learn how to be ready for the second coming of Christ. But the multitudes of the world population, even most Christians, do not understand this message. In fact, many aren't even interested in reading it. And yet this is the message, just like it was in John the Baptist's time. If you read the message that God has sent and follow it and follow instructions, you will get ready. You'll be ready for the second coming of Christ. This is what the message says. In Revelation, the 14th chapter, starting in the 6th verse, then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to Him. What does it mean to fear God and give glory to Him? It says in Proverbs 8 that to fear God means to hate evil, to depart from evil. If you're going, the very first part of the message is to fear God. That's what John the Baptist was preaching. To depart from evil. To fear God is to depart from evil. How can you give glory to God? It says, give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment has come, and worship Him who made heaven and earth, the sea and springs of water. It is an astounding fact that 1,800 years ago, more than 1,800 years ago, when this message was recorded, God had it recorded that in the last days, a message would go to all the world that people should worship God as the Creator. In fact, when you read this first angel's message, you will find that this angel quotes from the Ten Commandments. He quotes from the fourth commandment, which is the one commandment that deals with God as the Creator. It says, worship God as the Creator. Are you worshiping God as the Creator? The fourth commandment tells you how to do that. And then it says in Revelation 14:8, it says, and another angel followed, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Notice it says here that all the nations of the world are going to be deceived by the wine of the wrath of her fornication, by the sorceries. It says the same thing in Revelation 18:23. It says, the light of a lamp shall not shine in you, that's in Antichrist, anymore, and the voice of bridegroom and bride shall not be heard in you anymore, for your merchants were the great men of the earth, for by your sorcery all the nations were deceived. The third angel's message, the three angels' message is a message to come out from the wine of Babylon, from the deception that's taking the world captive. And then the third message, recorded in Revelation 14:9 to 12, says, a third angel followed, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast, that's the Antichrist, and his image, and receives his mark on his forehead or on his hand, he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast and his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. It's talking, of course, about the Antichrist, the image of the Antichrist, the mark of Antichrist. And it's calling people away from that, back to a religion that's based on the Word of God, on the commandments of God. That's why it closes. The third angel's message closes with this verse in Revelation 14:12. It says, here is the patience, that's the endurance or steadfast endurance, of the saints, the holy people, God's people in the last days. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Oh, friend. In an age of unbelievable lawlessness and unbelief, the last days are pointed out in Bible prophecy as to be a time of the greatest unbelief and scoffing and mocking against the religion of the Bible. But in a time of lawlessness and unbelief, it is pointed out that there is going to be a remnant of God that will be ready for Him to come. The third angel's message points it out in Revelation 14:12. There will be a people who keep God's commandments and have the faith of Jesus. They live by every word that proceeds out of God's mouth, not by human tradition. Oh, friend, will you be one of these people? The choice is yours today to choose where you're going to be at the end.
Today's free book is entitled, Once Saved, Always Saved. To receive your free copy, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer IM9. Do you know that you are saved? If so, how do you know? What are you saved from? Many Christians will tell you the very day that they were saved. But is it possible to be saved and then lose it? Is your faith backed up by the teachings of the Scriptures? This is a vital question that you cannot afford to get wrong. Your eternal destiny is at stake. Discover what God has to say about those who will be lost while believing they are saved. Get the answers to these questions and find out for yourself. Call today to get your copy of Once Saved, Always Saved. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH, that's 1-800-843-8788, and ask for offer IM9. From all of us here at Steps to Life Ministries, may God richly bless you.
Steps to Life.
We hope you have been as blessed by today's message as we have been in bringing it to you. We encourage you to contact us at Steps to Life Television with any questions or comments you might have.
Check 1-2, check 1-2.
Don't forget to ask for today's free offer.
Ready in 5.
Steps
4.
To Life Television, a ministry preparing a people for the soon coming of Jesus Christ.
Welcome, friends.
He can change your life.